Well, welcome to or welcome back to the 510 Report, where we talk about industry news, advocacy, and general goings-on. Thank you so much for joining me again. I do have one large news story that shockingly revolves around Scott Gottlieb and the FDA's recent press announcement. And I do definitely want to get to that, but there are a few things that I wanted to talk about first. I suppose we're going to file this under the general goings-on category of the 510 Report, but Battery Mooch has updated his recommended batteries spreadsheet. For anyone not aware, Battery Mooch has been a staple of our community for the last few years. He spends his time testing battery cells, the battery cells that we use in our vapor devices. It's incredibly important information to have, especially if you're a hobbyist vapor. And since he has started, Mooch has always had a recommended batteries list. I've used it more times than I can even count when I'm purchasing batteries. And his recommended battery table is like a living, breathing document that's constantly getting updated. But Battery Mooch posted on Reddit recently, "The new MechMod recommended batteries table has been uploaded to my blog on ECF. This table and the soon-to-be-released one for regulated mods replaces the existing recommended batteries table. Please delete any older versions of the table that you have. This table is not a list of all the best performing batteries for a mech. A battery is not bad if it's not on the table. It's just a few of my personal choices and some batteries to consider for vapors who are confused by the huge numbers of choices. There are dozens of great performing batteries, but the table needs to be kept small and many batteries have limited availability. Many of you will want to ask if the batteries you are using are okay in a mech. Run the Ohm's law equation for the coil resistances you are using and see how much current you are drawing from the battery. Compare that to its true current rating. I recommend staying under that rating unless you fully understand and accept the risks. This table can change at any time and will be updated whenever needed." Battery information and battery safety like this are just invaluable. Valuable things to have as a vapor. I'll be posting a link in the description to Mooch's updated recommended battery table. Thank you so much, Battery Mooch, for doing what you do. I've said this before and I'll probably say it again, you're doing God's work, sir. And another quick thing that I wanted to talk about stems from a tweet that Dimitri the Vaping Greek tweeted out not too long ago. The risk assessment analysis of a recent study by Johns Hopkins, which was all over the media and reported that e-cigarettes emit toxic level of metals. In fact, they do not. Johns Hopkins was wrong. This risk assessment analysis of this previous Johns Hopkins study was carried out by Konstantinos Farsalinos, Greek cardiologist, huge tobacco harm reduction advocate. And the Johns Hopkins study that Dimitri is referring to here came out February of 2018 and it had the big headline on it. Study: lead and other toxic metals found in e-cigarette vapors. Potentially dangerous levels of metals leak from some e-cigarette heating coils. And in this Johns Hopkins study, they say heavy metals like nickel, chromium, lead, and manganese were significantly present in the aerosol from an e-cig. They said the levels of these heavy metals were much higher than safety limits. So Konstantinos Farsalinos and his team did a risk assessment analysis using the same data and the same papers that Johns Hopkins used. Interestingly enough, they came to a slightly different conclusion. Electronic cigarette liquids contain trace levels of metals. For almost all metals, unrealistically high levels of liquid need to be consumed in order for total daily exposure to exceed established limits. So I feel like this is one of those things where I'm sure Johns Hopkins found these trace elements of heavy metals in the aerosol, in the vapor being produced by these e-cigs. But as with most negative vaping studies, and as Konstantinos Farsalinos points out, unrealistically high levels of e-liquid would need to be consumed before your exposure level exceeds these already established limits. Now, I don't think Johns Hopkins was wrong about this. I think they maybe just embellished a little bit or maybe exaggerated a little bit. I don't see why they would do that unless they needed this data to continue to fit the FDA narrative that these less harmful vapor products are actually harmful for you. Thank you so much to Dimitri for bringing that to my attention. Down in the description below, I'm going to post a link to the original Johns Hopkins study, as well as this updated risk assessment analysis from Konstantinos Farsalinos. And I think that's going to bring us to our big topic this week, and that is Scott Gottlieb and the FDA's big announcement on how they are going to curb youth use of vapor products. Spoiler alert, they want to use prescription drugs on your kids. But how did we get there? How did we get to the FDA wanting to give your kids prescription drugs drugs for possibly using a far less harmful vapor product. How did we get here? How did things become so crazy? I feel like we kind of need to start at the beginning to see how we got to where we are right now. So roughly in 2008, I'm gonna say, the United States starts purchasing the first e-cigarette products that really hit the market. We called them e-cigs back then just because China called them e-cigs. In hindsight, I wish we would have called them something else, but here we are. Over the next 5 years, the vaping market starts really growing exponentially. Tens of thousands of adult smokers start quitting combustible tobacco in favor of these vapor products. It was actually also in 2009 that the FDA, in an unprecedented move, tried to block shipments of NJOY branded products from China. The FDA claimed that they were importing an illegal drug delivery device. NJOY and Smoking Everywhere sued the FDA over this and won. On January 14th, 2010, the court granted the motion for a preliminary injunction and entered judgment in the favor of Smoking Everywhere and NJOY. Judge Richard Leon ruled that Congress did not intend tobacco products to be drugs merely because they deliver nicotine. If this were true, traditional cigarettes would also be a drug device combination product. The court also found that the intended use of electronic cigarettes is to encourage nicotine use rather than prevent or mitigate it. 2010 also saw the first proposed statewide vaping ban in California, which was thankfully vetoed. Between 2009 and 2013, we start seeing the first, like, real science and studies done on nicotine and vaping and vapor products by people like Konstantinos Farsalinos, the Greek cardiologist. He runs the ecigarette-research.org website, which is an incredible resource. And these studies showed pretty convincingly that vapor products were far, far less harmful for people than burning and inhaling smoke from combustible tobacco. Keeping in mind that in 2009, when I first started vaping, I had no idea if vapor products were better for me or not. The logical side of my brain said, yeah, absolutely they are. 3 to 4 ingredients in them, none of which are carcinogens. It made sense to me, and it made sense to a lot of people, and as far as I was concerned, I felt better and I was not smoking cigarettes anymore. And that was enough for me to kind of realize that these vapor products could really, really help a lot of smokers similar to myself. Heavy smokers, long-term smokers that have tried to quit in the past and failed. These vapor products could change everything. Vaping becomes more and more popular, and thousands of adult cigarette smokers are leaving combustible tobacco every single day, not using the pre-approved, FDA-approved pharmaceutical NRT products already on the market. Big tobacco obviously starts hemorrhaging money because all of these people are quitting tobacco. Big pharma is losing money because the people quitting aren't using their products to quit. And then it seems like in 2014, everybody started panicking. United States health officials start expressing their concerns that these vapor products will renormalize smoking. We start hearing the cries of, it's still smoking, it's just as bad for you as smoking, it's worse than smoking, and you're appealing to kids. 2014 was really the beginning of all the paranoia and fear-mongering in the United States regarding these vapor products. In April of 2014, the FDA reveals their first rules regarding e-cigarettes. These become known as the Deeming Regulations. The FDA had been under a lot of pressure from all sorts of public health groups like the American Lung Association, the American Cancer Society, the Truth Initiative, and the Campaign for Tobacco-Free Kids. It seems like every politician and public health official at that time had the same exact knee-jerk reaction. We don't know what's in this, but we better ban it. Rather than relying on science and evidence to make those decisions, they made the decisions first and then do the homework later. The FDA's plan in 2014, as far as I can tell, was to heavily regulate these products before it gets too big. We got to maintain that status quo of big tobacco selling you the disease and big pharma selling you the medicine. All federal, state, and local governments benefit monetarily from people smoking cigarettes. Big pharma benefits monetarily from people smoking cigarettes, and of course, big tobacco benefits monetarily from people smoking cigarettes. And these intrusive and consumer-driven products were and still are getting in the way of that. Then in early 2016, the FDA rolls out their newest revision of the Deeming Regulation for vapor products, which, if enacted as written, they would decimate the vapor industry and essentially hand the vapor industry over completely to the richest big tobacco and big pharmaceutical companies. This is kind of crony capitalism at its worst. Big tobacco and big pharmaceuticals are literally a cash cow for the federal government to buy jets or whatever. So when a consumer-driven product outside of their realm of regulation kind of swoops in and disrupts that whole balance of power and balance of money between big tobacco and big government and big pharma, what would we expect the FDA to do? They would probably try to ban it, which they tried to do and failed to do in 2009, or they can try to regulate it completely out of existence, or they can make sure that the industry either goes to the hands of big pharma or big tobacco so that the federal government can continue to reap the rewards of their very cozy relationship with these industries. Make no mistake about it. The reason that the FDA is going after vaping so hard is not for public health. The only reason is money. The only reason ever is money. So in 2016, we got our new FDA commissioner, Scott Gottlieb, and right away, he instantly started talking about things like nicotine and vaping and vapor products. We got one of his now most famous quotes ever. If you could take every adult smoker and fully switch them to e-cigarettes, that would have a substantial public health impact. And I know I've said this in the past, but ironically enough, now Scott himself is one of the people standing directly in the way of letting that massive public health impact even happen. Additionally, in 2016, the Royal College of Physicians, the largest and most respected group of doctors in the world, the same doctors that back in the 1950s first linked cigarette smoking to lung cancer. Pretty important doctors. They released their study on vaping entitled Nicotine Without Smoke, Tobacco Harm Reduction. This study is where the 95% less harmful for you statistic comes from. It actually says the hazard to health arising from long-term vapor inhalation from the e-cigarettes available today is unlikely to exceed 5% of the harm from smoking tobacco. Vaping starts to be embraced by the United Kingdom and some of Europe. Their smoking rates plummet. The MPs in the United Kingdom are actually pressured by public health groups to relax the regulations on vaping. They want as many smokers as possible to make that switch to vaping. Vaping was included in the United Kingdom's annual Stoptober Quit Smoking event, and United Kingdom health officials are hoping that with the help of vaping, they could have a smoke-free country by 2024. Meanwhile, in the United States, we have smokers being told that vaping is just as bad for them by public health officials, no less. Vaping bans, sales bans, flavor bans, and excessive taxation on vapor products start spreading throughout the United States. Now, I know we've done this in the past, but let's do it again just for fun. According to the CDC, roughly 11% of high school students admitted to using an e-cigarette within the last 30 days. This is what Scott Gottlieb and the FDA are calling an epidemic. Just to give you a little frame of reference, also according to the CDC, 30% of high school students admitted to drinking alcohol within the last 30 days. 14% of high school students admitted to binge drinking within the last 30 days. And 17% of high school students admitted to riding in a car with a driver that was intoxicated. If 11% of high school students admitting to using an e-cig within the last 30 days is considered an epidemic, then why isn't 14% of high school students binge drinking an epidemic? Am I wrong here? I mean, according to the FDA and Scott Gottlieb, these are epidemic levels of drinking. FDA is not concerned with that. FDA is only concerned with your kids getting access to far, far, far less harmful vapor products. And just how is Scott Gottlieb and the FDA going to address this vaping youth epidemic? Well, with prescription drugs, of course. On November 2nd, Scott Gottlieb and the FDA released the statement. Statement from FDA Commissioner Scott Gottlieb, MD, on the agency's continued efforts to address growing epidemic of youth e-cigarette use, including potential new therapies to support cessation. So the trend we've seen so far is kids were smoking. Youths were smoking. Youths quit smoking and start using vapor products. Youth smoking rates plummet. Youth vaping rates plummet. The FDA is obviously very concerned about this, and they're so concerned about this that they want to give your kids pharmaceutical drugs to help get them off of e-cigarettes. In a country where we actually have an opioid epidemic among young people, the FDA's solution is to give young people more prescription drugs. How is everybody not outraged by this? This press release makes many, many, many references to the youth vaping epidemic. They talk about their battle against nicotine. They talk about how parents are reaching out to the FDA to try to get some sort of guidance on how to get their kids away from these e-cigarettes. How about if you're a parent and you have kids, you parent your kids so that the FDA doesn't take away my freedoms? They even claim in this press release that teenagers have approached the FDA with concerns about their own e-cigarette nicotine addictions. I'm sure that definitely happened. The press release says, "Today we're announcing a public hearing to be held December 5th to discuss our efforts to eliminate youth e-cigarette use with a focus on the potential role of drug therapies to support cessation among youth and the issues impacting the development of such therapies for children. This hearing will also give us an opportunity to discuss the need for drug therapies to support youth cessation of other tobacco products, including combustible products such as cigarettes or cigars or smokeless tobacco products. All of these tobacco products pose serious dangers to teens and adolescent health. The FDA wants to give your children prescription drugs. This is their big plan. This is their big idea. How do we limit youth appeal to e-cigarettes? Easy, we give the kids drugs." Keeping in mind once again that all of this is based on zero data, zero evidence. They need to prove the epidemic. Towards the end, this press release says, "We cannot risk a whole generation of kids getting addicted to nicotine. We must put strategies in place now to help those who are already addicted quit. We will take additional actions in the coming months to address the public health concern of youth e-cigarettes and other tobacco product use with the goal of slowing and ultimately reversing these troubling trends." This is just lunacy to me. I could not believe my eyes when I was reading this press release. I don't know if I said it enough times in this 510 report already, but the FDA's solution to youth vaping is drugs? I mean, really? Prescription drugs for kids? Prescription drugs for kids to fight this made-up epidemic of youth vaping. I genuinely just feel like I'm taking crazy pills right now. As always, I would love, love, love to get your thoughts down in the comments below on this topic. And honestly, I think that's where we're gonna end this week's 510 report. On a little bit of a personal note, this will be the last 510 report for about 2 weeks or so. I will be gone getting married and honeymooning for the next few weeks, but we're gonna come back to the 510 report and pick up right where we left off as soon as I get back. And I can't end this 510 report without mentioning CASA. Go to CASA.org, sign up. It's free, it's easy, it's effective. If you wanna know about possible bad vape legislation coming up in your particular city, area, or state, join CASA. They send you emails. Follow those calls to actions. Thank you so much, everybody, for watching. And as Kevin Skipper always used to say, you don't have to do everything, but you do have to do something. Let's get involved.